around this country and in the state of Minnesota. Our governor, Tim Walz, has failed to take action. And rather than heed the voices of those who have been most impacted by police violence, he has advocated for tens of millions of dollars to go towards policing. He has also authorized Operation Safety Net, which has acted as a reign of terror upon the African American community, as well as peaceful demonstrators, as well as Black youth. We saw Operation Safety Net in full effect after the most recent police killing of a young Black man, and that was Dante Wright just over a week ago. Our governor has not expressed empathy. He has perpetuated violence through the use of a multi-jurisdictional task force that has been allowed to use rubber bullets, flashbang grenades, tear gas, intimidation, and arrests upon peaceful protesters. Rather than Governor Walz taking accountability, he has doubled down on the human rights abuses and civil rights abuses that have happened to individuals as well as journalists in the state of Minnesota. He has also invited law enforcement from places like Ohio and Nebraska to join the police forces here and the National Guard, who are already all over the streets with their tanks and high-powered weapons. They make us feel unsafe as Black residents of Minnesota. His actions are unconscionable. President Joe Biden needs to step in and needs to use his executive authority to address this situation and even to repeal the 1033 program, which has allowed for police departments around the country, including some in Minnesota, to purchase high-powered military weapons and tanks from the federal government. And those tanks and those weapons are used against Black residents, Native residents, people of color, and poor people, including homeless people, here in the Twin Cities in the state of Minnesota. We know that President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris have a history in perpetuating criminal justice laws and policies that harm Black people and other people of color. We know that they apologize for their roles while running for office. And what we are saying to them today is, you can keep your apologies. We want to see action. We want to see them overhaul the criminal justice system, which currently has over 2 million people incarcerated, 40% of whom are people of color, the majority of whom are poor people, and over 50% of people have an underlying mental health issue. We know that they have been involved in enforcing drug war policies. The war on drugs has been a war on Black, brown, and poor bodies. It is up to the executive leadership of this nation to take action with the power that they have, their influence, and their executive authority to repeal the war on drugs and the laws that comprise the war on drugs. We are suffering as Black people in the state of Minnesota. We do not feel safe. We know that at any moment, police officers can kill yet another Black body and get away with it. In spite of what we heard during the Derek Chauvin trial, this is not just about one bad apple. This is about a rotten system. Yeah. And Derek Chauvin is a part of that rotten fruit that was produced from a rotten system. The culture itself will not change, even with a guilty verdict. We want to see a conviction. We need to see a conviction. But even more importantly, we need to see an overhaul of this entire system to protect and preserve Black bodies, so that we can live as full citizens of these United States. Thank you.
Mike, I'd like to invite Attorney Andrew Gordon, who is the Deputy Director of the Legal Rights Center.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Andrew Gordon. I'm the Deputy Director of Community Legal Services at the Legal Rights Center. It's a nonprofit public defender corporation located here in Minneapolis. I'm an attorney, I represent individuals charged with crimes both in adult court and in juvenile court here. I've seen the harm that policing has had on my clients. I've seen the harm it's had on this community, and specifically black and brown bodies, people from impoverished backgrounds, people who have been marginalized and left disempowered by the systemic violence visited upon them by law enforcement and by the court system and by the criminal legal system. We're asking for change. We're asking for accountability. And it's clear, especially from the actions of the last week, that Hennepin County, the city of Minneapolis, the city of Brooklyn Center, and the state of Minnesota writ large are parties to violence to black and brown bodies. And that has to stop. We can't trust our local systems. We don't trust our local systems. And so we need outside help. And so we stand in solidarity with all the folks up here and all the folks counting for change, calling for accountability, and calling for the federal government to step in to offer that help, to offer that aid, and to make accountability here in Minnesota a reality as opposed to a pipe dream. I'm going to thank you very much. I'm going to turn it over to, I don't know who's next, but Muhammad, back to Muhammad. Thank
you. Next, I'd like to invite the Executive Director of CARE Minnesota, Jaylani Hussein.
My name is Jaylani Hussein. I'm the Executive Director for the Council on American Islamic Relations Minnesota Chapter, Jaylanihussein. I am here today asking the federal government to do its part. For the first time in a very long time, we have a federal government that is being led by one party, the Democratic Party, a party that has promised the people of color for a very long time that they care about the issues of brown and black lives. The Democratic Party right now controls the House, the Senate, and the executive branch. We are asking President Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris to not give us any more sympathies, but to bring forth solutions. Sympathies did not save George Floyd. Only solutions can save another killing. And while we watched this horrific trial traumatize the country once again, we are now 12 miles from where 20-year-old Dante Wright was killed. And reality and a gut check to all of us that nothing has fundamentally changed outside this courthouse to save lives in this country. Dante Wright's killing is a testament that it is urgency now, and we need federal legislation that can hold police accountable. We know at this moment, Republicans have wrapped themselves around white supremacy. They have wrapped themselves around police officers who are killer officers. They have historically done this, and they are doing it once again. But the people in charge who have the power right now are not Republicans in the federal government. It is the Democrats and those who voted for them. It is now the right time to act. The country and the entire world is waiting for a verdict. But we know, regardless of what the outcome of this verdict, it will not save Dante Wright, and it's not going to save the countless names that may come after. That is why we need accountability. We are asking for the Biden administration, as they have already commented on this case, to comment about what they are going to do in the next 6 months before the midterms start to bring forth that can actually bring forth meaningful legislation. We believe they need to go beyond the current legislation that we have, because we know across this country there are many places that may never bring forth any police accountability, but only federal laws will bring that accountability. We know that. Even in the state that killed George Floyd here in Minnesota, we have been trying to pass police accountability bills. And sadly, until now, nothing has happened. Nothing has happened in the state of Minnesota to hold police accountable. While states like Maryland, New York, and others are passing bills around qualified immunity and others, the state that killed George Floyd has passed no police accountability. And it is Democrat-controlled House that has yet to pass police accountability. The first time we saw them returning our calls was when Dante Wright was killed. And it's a shame that we have to have more bodies and more hashtags for us to get justice. We are demanding justice inside that courthouse. We are also demanding justice outside the courthouse. Because if we only get justice inside the courthouse, we will have injustice outside the courthouse. And so that is why we are reminding the public in this moment not to put all of their hope into a verdict inside that courthouse, but to put their hope in each other and put their hope in themselves in demanding accountability. This is a moment for our nation, our state. Derek Chauvin is not the only one on trial. Police departments across this country are on trial. The elected officials who have failed miserably, who led us to this moment, are on trial. And the federal leaders who ran on the politics of bringing us together, the politics of holding police accountable, are also on trial. And the final point that I want to make in this moment is Black people in this country are tired. We are tired from the fact that many people have taken this issue on as an anomaly, that it's one officer, one incident. This continues to happen every single day all over this country, whether we see it in the light of a camera or in the darkness that we may never find, whether we see it on our footage or we may never hear about it because it is inside the darkest place in America. A prison cell is the darkest place in America, because for the longest time, police who have not killed us have put us into prison. Police who have not killed us have brought forth mass incarceration in this country. And while right now we have an epidemic of fentanyl and other types of drugs, we have seen the response of treating those individuals as people who need help, people who need medical attention, not a prison cell.
That's right.
And we believe that is the same case for those who have been brought up against other types of drugs, who they themselves have called out for help. So in this moment right now, we call on federal government, President Biden, you need to come to the state, you need to come to Minnesota. Yeah. It is time for you to meet the people, and it's time for you to actually deliver what you told. Don't cry on the shoulders of families and fail families who are going to be killed by a system that you are responsible for. And so we will fight. We will continue this fight. When the cameras leave, we will not leave until justice is brought forth by any means necessary.
Next, I'd like to invite Delshia Perry with Be Their Voices.
Good afternoon, everyone. I want you all to take a real good look at this picture right here and the name that is attached to it. Good afternoon. My name is Delshia Perry, the mother of Hardell Sherrill. This was my only child. Accountability. Accountability is what I am calling for President Biden and Vice President to do. And just as my brother Jelani said, they need to come. I appreciate the prayers, but I'm a prayer warrior, and I got a lot of prayer warriors that pray for me, but that is not what I need. That is not what we need. We are a hurting people, and we need you to come. For those of us that have voted you all in, you need to come and show us that you are listening and that you care. So come to Minnesota. We challenge you, President Biden, to come to Minnesota, to hear the real truth of what has been going on in the state of Minnesota, in addition to the policing and the rotten, evil wickedness of the police officers that have done what they have done to George Floyd and Dante Wright. but also the correctional officers that need to be held accountable for actions such as this. My son walked into the Beltrami County Jail on August 24th of 2018. And I'm just gonna tell you the Reader's Digest version, but I challenge you today to go and Google his name to see how they treated my son. 9 days later, he's carried out in a body bag. And while he was carried out in that body bag, he was medically neglected. They starved my baby to death. They did not care to treat him with what he had, which was very treatable, GBS. My son cried out for help, and they didn't care because they're ruthless and they're racist. And I say, no more. I started an organization called Be Their Voices because we will be their voices and they will be heard. I started this organization for so many other reasons as well, because other families like this woman here, they called me because they saw that I was getting some traction in what was happening in my son's case. And they said, can you help us too? And I said, surely I will. That was one call, then another call, then another call. And before you know it, I was 6, 7, 8 calls of families that are leaning on me. And I thank God he's given me the strength to carry not just myself and give me the strength to carry on, but to also help them along the way. And I thank God that one of the mothers, the sisters has come out to tell you her story about how corrupt the jail system is, and y'all know it runs over into the prison system. Right. It is a system that is guilty as hell. Right. And I'm gonna let Clara speak on behalf of her nephew, Naj Powell. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you for Be Their Voices and Delshia. I'm speaking on behalf of my sister, Tabitha Turner, Tabitha Prosper, and of course, Naja Conadonis Powell. I should not be here today. I shouldn't be here. And I never thought I would be speaking to cameras about what's just and what's unjust. My nephew went into Hennepin County Hospital Mental Health to get help because he had a disorder, a mental health disorder. He left out days later because the hospital called the police because he refused to take medication that was, he wasn't feeling good with the medication. They called the police. The police picked him up from Hennepin County Hospital. Hours later, they put him in a cell by himself, in a cell with everything that could cause him to hang himself. They picked him up from a mental health ward and put him in a room with a bullet in it. A jail cell with sheets and bunk beds and left him there. Later, they came and found him dead. We shouldn't be here. And I say the system is so unjust. And it's not just the system that's unjust. It's unjust people who work in the systems.
Yes.
So
yes.
It's bigger than that. It's bigger than the change in the system. Change the people who you hire these systems.
That's right.
I come with a different mindset. We know this isn't working. We know who the clear enemy is. I didn't vote for Biden, and I'm going to say it. Yeah, he needed to bring his ass here. He needs to come.
That's right. That's right.
We shouldn't have to have this conversation. I stand in the shoes of my ancestors. I stand in their shoes, and they will be sorely disappointed that we're still having this conversation today. So I ask that there needs to be a full separation, period, point blank. I don't want to live amongst my enemies. It makes no sense. We can't keep having killing after killing after killing. How many more gotta go? How many more before we realize, and I'm about to wrap it up. How many more? And I'm done. I said what I had to say. Ashe.
Next, I'd like to invite the president of the Minnesota Justice Coalition, Jonathan McClellan.
Hello, my name is Jonathan McClellan. I'm the president of the Minnesota Justice Coalition. We're a collective of organizations that work with the families and legislators here in the state of Minnesota to pass legislation, as well as in Washington, D.C. On April 9th, the Minnesota Senate defeated a measure that would terminate the employment of police officers who engaged in or affiliated themselves with white supremacy. And this is the state of affairs that we find ourselves in today. In addition to that, we are also aware that the FBI has sent letters to the police departments here in the state of Minnesota informing them of infiltration by white supremacy organizations. On March 29th, our collective of organizations wrote a letter to the congressional delegation here in Minnesota, the President Biden, as well as the Attorney General of the United States. And in that letter, it states, "We write today to seek and advocate for the reintroduction of the patterns and practices investigations of law enforcement in the state of Minnesota. From the time of Reconstruction through the Civil Rights Movement, the federal government has been a critical partner in regressing harms and systemic injustice. Particularly, the Federal Bureau of Investigation has, at critical moments, been instrumental in bringing light and accountability to state and municipal governments that would otherwise be scrutinized. The patterns of practice investigations here in the state of Minnesota were an example of just such accountability that began after the murder of Philando Castile. It was a matter of great distress to all of us that this program was suspended under the previous administration. That is why it is with urgency and respect that we seek to restart the patterns and practices investigations here in the state of Minnesota. The lack of trust in local law enforcement, the city officials, along with the murders leading up to George Floyd and the ones after, and the continuing assault on our communities, primarily of color, by law enforcement, warrant an intervention from the FBI. It is important that through an independent investigation, bring light of any patterns and practices that may exist. This is needed to heal the community, as well as find areas that need reform and ultimately obtain justice and build public trust in our institutions that are supposed to protect us. In order to solve the problems before us, we are taught you have to recognize that there is a problem to begin with. Without that recognition, we create a system within our law enforcement for the Derek Chauvins to thrive. Our system is broken, people are being hurt and are dying, and we need your help to bring about the change and adherence to the Constitution. Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, it's time for you to jump into this fight,
yes,
and show that you are different than the previous administration.
Yes.
We're waiting.
That's right.
Right. Next, I'd like to invite Chantel Allen with Black Lives Matter, Twin Cities Metro.
How you doing? My name is Chantel Allen, C-H-A-U-N-T-Y-L-L-A-L-L-E-N. I'm with Black Lives Matter Twin Cities. And I'm also on the St. Paul School Board. As Brother Jelani said, we're tired. How many bodies do we have to lose? This is clearly a movement, and it's not just a local movement. This is a national movement. We've been saying Black Lives Matter across this nation for 7-8 years now. People have been getting killed across this nation unjustly for 400 years now. This is just an extension of several movements from our ancestors. This is an extension of the Underground Railroad to freedom. This is an extension of the Civil Rights Movement. This is an extension of the Black Panther movement. At that time, presidents stepped up. They said, this is not what our Constitution represents. Clearly here in the state of Minnesota, this is not what our Constitution represents. We are demanding that President Biden and Vice President Kamala get involved today. Our legislators are not making any moves. This system is broken. It's not just the police officers. It's the judges. It's the legislators that won't even hear our voices. They won't even look at our bills. We need you to get involved. We need to start a reckoning in this country with Black folks. It's time. We are 400, really 500 years in. When is it gonna be a change? You guys ran on that ticket saying it's time for change, right? You said that you were gonna be different, but I don't feel any different. I woke up the next morning after you got inaugurated and it still felt like white supremacists were at my back door. At what point are you guys gonna say enough is enough? Because we've been screaming it for years. Enough is enough. And Black lives have to matter in this country. Yeah. And you know that economically they have to matter.
Come on now.
Culturally, they have to matter. We see it all over the TV. We feel it when the 1% is capitalizing off of our work and labor. We are an important piece of this democracy. You need to step up now. If you want this country to continue to be seen as land of the free and home of the brave and full of the liberties, you've got to step up and make that happen. We need President Biden and Vice President Kamala here. Get in your plane. I've seen it take off before. You can walk out your back door. Get here. Today, we need you in Minnesota. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to bring up the co-executive director of the Minnesota Freedom Front, Elijah Dares.
All right. We're going to read a statement by the Minnesota Freedom Fund. My name is Elijah Dares. I'm the executive director of the Minnesota Freedom Fund. Again, I am the co-executive director of the Minnesota Freedom Fund. Our mission is to pay criminal bail and immigration bond for those that cannot afford it. As we seek to end discriminatory and intimidating and oppressive money bail, that is our mission, that is what we do. It wasn't an easy road for me to get to where I am today. I spent 17 years of my life incarcerated right here in Minnesota. I was incarcerated beginning at the age of 15. I was certified and sentenced to a life prison sentence. The judge told me, you'll spend the rest of your natural life in the care of the Commission of Corrections. He told me I would die in there. They told me I would die in there. I grew up in jails and prisons across Minnesota. I know how spending even one weekend locked up can cause harm, both mentally and physically. I know what our system does to millions of people across this country every single year, especially Black men like me and Black men like George Floyd. That is why I'm standing here today with all of my comrades, that we stomp out here in these streets routinely. We out there in these suites routinely, chopping it up with these elected officials, holding accountable any of the officers or any of the other individuals representing this here government, holding them accountable for how they treat us right here in the state of Minnesota. Some people call it the Jim Crow of the North. In Minnesota, like many places in this country, you sit in jail if you cannot afford bail. We have people sitting in jails just because they can't afford $78.
Right.
Research it, look it up. We pay $78 bails for people. In Minnesota, it costs an average of about $140 a night to hold someone inside of a jail cell. How does that make any sense? You are punished for being poor, and the system works completely differently for you in the state of Minnesota. On any given day in Minnesota, 6,000 people are sitting in jails in pretrial because they cannot afford bail, and hundreds more are sitting inside of immigration detention facilities across the state of Minnesota. These people are impacted every single day that they sit in jail cells, and they're impacted by this harmful and unnecessary system. We're talking very low-level crimes. President Biden, on the campaign trail, you pledged to end money bail. That was your campaign pledge. That's what you said you was gonna honor. You called it modern day debtor's prison. That's what you said. You said it's a modern day debtor's prison. And it is. That is why we're asking you to live up to your pledge. We are here today because of the murder of George Floyd. The murder of yet another black man at the hands of another arm of our criminal legal system. That's why I said criminal legal system. I didn't say criminal justice system. I said the criminal legal system. Some people get justice. Other people just get the criminal legal system. It's a system that criminalizes you for being poor, for being black, for being brown, for being indigenous. We are writing a new script, and we're not going back. We ain't going back. That's them old days. You see, with them pandemic came in, we said we're gonna roll back some of them old practices. We're gonna bring in some new ways of interfacing and interacting with this here system. Not just in Minneapolis, not just in Minnesota, all across America. We're going forward, and we need our elected officials to join us as we move forward with this new way of living. And we bring it, y'all don't see these people behind us? We're not playing any games out here. We're bringing forth the dawn of a new era. Yeah. That's some old days, and them days are dead. Yeah. We're a different people, and we're bringing it strong. We recognize what the real virus is. That's right. And we the antivirus. That's right. And we're coming to put an end to that. Yeah. That's some old days. Yeah. That's some old ways. Okay. That's dead. We're here, and we ain't playing no more games.
Next, I'd like to invite the president of the Minneapolis NAACP, Angela Rose Myers.
All right, Angela. Hello, everyone. My name is Angela Rose Myers. I am the president of the Minneapolis NAACP, which stands for the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. And I'm here today to stand with community members. I'm here today to stand with black community members. Yeah. We are calling for change on every single level.
Say that.
When it comes from the schools, when it comes from the city council, when it comes from the mayor, when it comes from the police, when it comes from the president of the United States of America, we need change. In my mind this morning, I'm thinking of a lyric from Meek Mill. He says, "What's free? Slavery was abolished, and yet the amendment that abolished slavery opened up the door for the mass incarceration system that we have today." This morning, I'm thinking of Mayon Burrell, a man who was unjustly incarcerated for a crime he did not commit. And he is still fighting for his innocence, although he is not on in the prison system, he is still not innocent in the eyes of our government. So what's free? I'm thinking today of Dante Wright, who was murdered last week on a Sunday, and they said because of expired tabs. They said that he had a warrant for his arrest that he needed to pay $156. So what's free? When you cannot afford to pay to renew your expired tabs, when you cannot afford to pay $156 so that you can get clean from a warrant. So what's free? Because it sounds like in the United States of America, poor people and black people are being unjustly incarcerated and they're being put on modern day plantations to benefit somebody. They're being pulled from our communities and let's be honest, could benefit somebody. I wanna be honest as well, in the state of Minnesota, we have these huge prisons in St. Cloud, Minnesota, in Stillwater, Minnesota. And when it comes to the census, okay, the census that puts money into black communities, right, based on the population in those communities, they have kidnapped our brothers and sisters and siblings, and they have actually count those people in Stillwater, Minnesota, and St. Cloud, Minnesota, and we are losing federal money for that. So let's, as I really want to impress upon you this question. What's free? Are we truly free? And until we are all free, there will be no peace.
Hey, that's right.
Until there is truly justice.
That's right.
Until there is truly a place where Black Minnesotans can feel safe.
That's right.
Okay, somebody talked to me today this morning, and I'm going to say this last. And they said, well, what about keeping communities safe? When I was telling them about the OSN, Operation Safety Net.
Yeah.
President Biden, how do you feel about Governor Waltz using military, federal funded military in Minneapolis when there have been peaceful protests in Minneapolis all week? He has been preparing for months using federal dollars, using military in the streets to harm, target, tear gas, peaceful protesters.
Yeah.
So my question is, somebody said to me, they said, how else are we supposed to keep our communities safe? Black people have never been safe in this country. So once we get to a place where Black people are safe in this country, where Black people see justice in this country, and until Black people are free in this country, none of us are free.
Next, I'd like to invite TT Bidikayo with We Win Institute.
I'm TT Layo Bidiako, Executive Director of We Win Institute. Our mission is the academic and social success of all children. I'm traumatized. Our people are traumatized. This keeps happening and happening. I'm also a mother of a Black son. Minneapolis is very familiar with beating and killing Black men and boys. 15 years ago, because they could, the police jumped and beat my son. We fast forward. I have a parent that her children were in our program, and now her nephew is dead. We have a parent over here for no good reason. Son is dead. This is the trajectory for Black people in Minneapolis. It's called white supremacy. White supremacy on every level. 19% of Black children in the Minneapolis public schools are reading at grade level. How come they can teach white children how to read, but they can't teach Black children how to read? We know in Minneapolis and St. Paul what they feel like in Afghanistan and Syria. We have tanks here. We have rubber bullets and other armory being launched at our people for no other reason than the fact that we are Black. Brothers and sisters are calling for Biden and Kamala Harris to come here. Why that happens? How about having our governor come here and apologize to our parents? They're always telling us not to be violent. At what point are they going to start telling the police not to be violent towards us? Did Walls go and apologize to Dante Wright's mother and sister? Did he go to their house? Did he offer reparations to any of our families?
No.
They need to stand up and be counted. And the funny thing about white supremacy, we saw it last night. Now we know that if Chauvin gets off, it's Maxine Waters' fault. White supremacy at its best. Leave your hands off of our people. Yes. Leave your hands off of our children. Yes. Stand up and be counted.
Yes. Next, I'd like to invite DJ with TCC Twin Cities Justice for Jamar.
Oh, man. So the first thing I want to talk about is the war on drugs, right? And I want to explain why, I want to understand why they always feel like the need to go to war with black people over everything. I want to talk about how they put the drugs in our community and then declared it a war as a way to destroy the black community and the family unit. But when white people get addicted to drugs, then all of a sudden it's no longer a war on the drugs. It's a pandemic, right? An opioid pandemic. I want to talk about when black people go out on the street to seek justice, to seek healing, to seek what is right and just. I want to talk about why they're met with tear gas, why they're met with rubber bullets and flashbangs. Yet when white people go to the Capitol with guns and rifles and break in, they're treated with open arms. We need to stop going to war with black people. We need to end Operation Safety Net. Because it's disgusting that I could say, as a 26-year-old black man who lives in this community that is trying to use his First Amendment rights to get justice, that I know what it feels like to go to war. That's not right. And then to see them in their press conference bragging, justifying what they're doing to us, saying, oh, we had to shoot tear gas. We had to shoot rubber bullets. They had shields. They had umbrellas. They had gas masks. How do you hurt someone with those things? Those are defensive things. Those aren't weapons. Those are things that we are using to defend ourselves from this military occupation. Next, I want to talk about Tim Fascist Walz. He declared a state of emergency yesterday. The only emergency I see in this state is the whole United States needs to focus, everyone in the United States is focusing on BIPOC people and they can't just live their lives, right? Why is it that the cops feel like black joy and us just living our lives is a problem? When we have white terrorists every week going out and committing mass murder that come back safely, but we could just be living our lives. We could just want our car to smell a little bit good. And then we have to die for that. Someone say that ain't right.
That ain't right.
Someone say that ain't right.
That ain't right.
The real state of emergency is the fact that the cop killings persist despite the fact that we're having this trial for Floyd. The real state of emergency is the fact that our government values property over people. The real state of emergency is the fact that we waste $35 million on a military occupation in the middle of a global pandemic where most people can't even afford to survive. The real state of emergency is the fact that our government went to war with black, brown, and indigenous youth last week that was seeking justice for someone in their community while accepting white supremacy. That's the real state of emergency. The fact of the matter is they can convict him all they want, but there still hasn't been any laws passed. And you know what message that sends to the cops in Minneapolis and throughout the United States? That tells them that it's okay to lynch us. They just gotta do it faster. Because the only way that anyone's going to care in America is if it happens for 9 minutes.
Come on now.
Dante Wright, where's the justice for him? Why isn't everyone up in arms for Dante Wright? Why isn't everyone up in arms for Dalai E? That happened in the same time period. Because they haven't passed any laws, and since their death happened within seconds or minutes, it's fine. As long as it doesn't happen for 9 minutes when you're torturing them, it's fine. And that's the message that they're sending to the officers.
Right.
Someone say, that ain't right.
That ain't right.
Someone say, that ain't right.
That ain't right.
So they need to end Operation Safety Net. They need to stop declaring war on our black and brown and indigenous youth. And they continue to do that because apparently, even though they terrorized us for the last 9 days, it's not enough. They have to have reinforcements from Ohio. They got to have reinforcements from Nebraska. It's not enough. Even though they have riot gear, even though they have tear gas, for some reason, they need more. Because they plan on to continue to go to war with us. Someone say, that ain't right.
That ain't right.
Someone say, that ain't right.
That ain't right.
So we need to make sure that we're out here getting justice for Floyd, but we got to realize that this movement is bigger than Floyd, because we're out here trying to get justice for all stolen lives.
Yeah.
So we need Biden to be the president that the liberals promised he was going to be, and not be more the same that the last administration was for the last 4 years. The Floyd bill y'all have is incremental change. What we need is change now. Well, I hear from a lot of white people, and they like to tell me that that change comes slowly. You know, it's real easy to say that, right? When you don't have to suffer. It's real easy to say that when you don't have to endure the pain. I want this pain to end now. Kids to feel safe now. So. What we need is the type of change that the families are pushing for at the state legislature. That's what we need to see at the federal level.
Yeah.
What we need is things like community control of the police, which was pushed by the Black Panthers before they were infiltrated and lynched.
Yeah, that's right.
And the people, and we need, and we have these people pushing that type of legislation all around the country. With NARPR, the National Alliance Against Racial and Political Repression, and all their affiliates around the country. Now we need to start pushing it at a federal level, though. And with that being said, I want to invite Biden to come here and to talk with us. I want to invite Biden to do something. I want to invite Biden to do something that's actually going to matter.
Yeah.
Something that's actually going to get us changed. Because
yeah.
Right now you're lollygagging and we don't got time for it, because my brothers, my sister, my non-binary folks, they're still getting killed.
That's right. Yes. That's
all right. Power to the people.
All power to the people.
Next, I'd like to invite Senior Pastor Byron Heron from Zion Baptist Church.
All right, Pastor Heron.
I was listening to the governor, and one of the things he said was, we need to listen to the people who are out there raising their voices.
Yeah.
Well, why aren't you listening?
Right.
If you were listening, you wouldn't be bringing folk in from other states.
Listen.
Escalating this thing. They have no investment in our community. You're not thinking about the black bodies. Nobody thinks about the bodies. All we think about is property, property and profit.
Yep.
But no one thinks about real lives and black lives in particular.
Yes.
I keep hearing people saying, if Dante hadn't resisted, he'd still be alive. That's a lie. We've seen it.
Yes.
Stop telling us to stop believing what we see. I saw a scared little boy. I know he's a young man, but when I watched that, I saw a scared little boy. And I saw an officer who was trying to talk to him, and I saw another officer come out of nowhere interfering. yelling taser but holding a weapon. I have stayed away because my heart is so hurt. And I had to do some work on me because you can't be out here with a bad heart. And I want to speak peace. But there is no peace if you're not willing to give us justice. Peace and justice go together. It's biblical. If you want people to be a certain way, and if you want your city to be a certain way, then you have to create a just city where every person is valued, yeah, where everyone has value, and where everyone is treated like they have value. Yeah. And if you don't do that, then there's no peace. If you don't want protests, if you don't want buildings burning, then stop doing the things that cause it. In the trial, they were talking about how hostile the bystanders were getting. Well, if you want them to stop being hostile, take your knee off his neck. You can't ask for one thing and keep doing another thing that keeps bringing about the results that you're getting. It's time for us to come together and to talk together. We need a meeting with the governor, y'all. We need a meeting with the governor. We need a meeting with the president. President Biden and Kamala Harris, they promised some things. And we need to hold them accountable for what they promised, because they wouldn't be there if it wasn't for us. They wouldn't be there. And we're tired of being ignored. Yes. We're tired of being treated like we're not human. And we're tired of always trying to prove our humanity. We shouldn't have to prove our humanity. What is this about always having to talk about when somebody, when the police do something to somebody, they start talking about their record. They start, does that mean that you have a right to kill us? I'm angry, y'all, and I'm trying to be angry in a righteous way, not in a way that does damage and not in a way that causes damage, but in a way that speaks to change and in a way that speaks to peace and in a way that speaks to transforming systems and governments. We need a commission. We need a truth and reconciliation transformation commission. Just like South Africa had, that really looks deep into the systemic racism and white terrorism in this country, and then makes recommendations that doesn't get shelved, but begins to be enacted. It is amazing to me that we have a country that polices every other country and talks about human rights. And this is a human rights issue. This isn't a civil rights issue. This is a human rights issue. And it's always been a human rights issue. Even the United Nations have called the United States into question. But you don't hear about it, and you don't see those reports. But it's time for us to lift our voice. We're not going to stop, y'all.
That's right.
We're not going to stop.
That's right.
And if it cost us our lives, I'm dying.
Yep.
I'm dying.
Mm-hmm. Right there with you.
If physical death is the price we must pay to free our children from a lifetime of psychological death, then nothing could be more honorable. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
And I'm going to invite our last speaker, then I'm going to start opening it up for some questions. And our last speaker is Zainab Mohammed, Community Advocacy Manager with CARE Minnesota.
All right, Zainab.
Thank you, everybody. I stand here in solidarity with all of these community leaders. And I stand here as somebody who has lost faith, not only in the justice system in America, but our governor and Democrats who ran on policies that want to reform the criminal justice system, that hold police accountable, But what we've learned all this year is that the same people that want to hold the system accountable are the same people that would rather save seats to make sure that Republicans don't take it. So like many people here, I'm sick and tired of black people having black people come to when you want votes. But when we come to you to pass accountability bills or to hold the justice system accountable, you do not open your door. So why is it that we continuously open our doors for you? So we're asking President Biden, because we have lost faith in Tim Walz. He's the same individual that just yesterday introduced a $9 million at the Minnesota Senate to bring more cops from outside jurisdictions to our state that will not be held accountable. And he has yet to say anything about police accountability bills. So we're asking President Biden and Kamala Harris and Tim Walz to do your job, because Tim Walz is right. We are in a state of emergency because black people are dying. And, and under his leadership, many black people have died. So he's got murder on his hands. So it's time you do your job and hold this system accountable, because we know it works for you when it's time to hold the black officer accountable. Yes. So do your job.
Yes. 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 Yes.
And quickly before we take questions, I'd like to invite Chelsea Nagers to do a quick piece, a spoken word piece.
Hello, everyone. While I was just down here to listen, I felt it on my heart. I do spoken word to read this piece that I wrote a couple days ago. All right, it's called Dante Wright. We're tired of getting killed. We're tired of having to heal. In my city, one officer's trial's not even over before 12 recklessly pulling their steel. Mm-hmm. Women or man, behind that badge, there's many cowards in disguise overstepping their stand. Okay. Using their uniform to casually inflict their racist, malice, hate. Is too many officers okay with being our ending fate? By our, I mean black people. Because they've been killing us compared to white people at an astronomically higher rate. Pride too high to see when they're wrong. You're a 26-year veteran, man. You knew what was going on. Yeah. After all these years, really? Accidental discharge of your firearm? Mm. You thought it was a taser. Even though you clutched it from your dominant side, you can't say they weigh the same. We all know that's a lie. Why don't you tell the truth, Officer Potter? Your nerves got the best of you while attempting to arrest an unarmed black man. Yeah. Easier to shoot instead of putting your gun down where you stand. If you can't take the heat, get the hell out the kitchen. If you're scared of the assailant, let backup finish that mission. And fear for your life is different than someone unarmed resisting arrest in broad daylight. People mad they tearing the city up. We mad 12 steady sending our people up. So many to name, this ain't right. But this one I wrote for you, say his name, Dante Wright. Thank you.
I'm gonna open up for some questions.
Question for you guys. My name is Jamal Andrews. I'm a reporter with Nosy out of Chicago. Obviously, the theme of this press conference has been to bring in the federal government, to bring in President Biden, Kamala Harris, and obviously they ran on reform rather than that sort of transformative change that you all have been mentioning. And my question for you all is, I guess, why do you have faith that it'll work out bringing in the federal government based on what we have heard from them on the campaign trail?
The first problem is they haven't even started with reform, let alone transformation. And we don't have faith in them, but we do have a duty to hold them accountable for what they ran on. Yeah. They came and knocked on the door of the black community to get elected, and now it's time to pay the price for our votes. We are not like some of the black politicians that are happy sitting around a table with them. We are demanding justice. Yeah. And they can appease those people, but they still have to answer to the black community at large. Yeah. We are the ones who are suffering under the weight of oppression, and we expect them to live up to their responsibilities as the leaders of the free world.
Yeah. I'll add to that. The Democrats have no more excuses. This isn't just about Biden and Harris. They control all the three houses. And so if they fail, It's the Democratic Party that continued to fail, and in this time, they have no Republicans to blame.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Yes. Any other questions?
So first of all, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party sadly are the same.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The Republican Party freed the slaves, so-called. So we know for sure that both parties have historically failed communities of color. One party likes to be right next to us. Another party likes to stand next to the police with their dogs. But the reality is that this country is built on the backs of black people, indigenous people. And this country has failed the Native American people and black people for so long. So I think it might be the right time for poor people in this country, black people in this country, and many folks who are tired of the broken political system to maybe create an independent party that will bring forth the People's Party, that will bring forth. But right now, the Democratic Party, until 2022, is on the clock. We will see what they do. And after that, I think people are no longer going back. We are going forward. And that may mean without both of these parties.
I just want to add to that a little bit, because I do agree with my brother. But I also think that we have to start grooming and running people for office. It's not enough to just vote for folk who just come up and say they're running for office, but who do we want in office?
Exactly.
How do we groom them, and how do we prepare them to be in office that we are supporting folk who have our best interests at heart? It doesn't matter whether you're Democrat or Republican, neither party has served us well, you know? But if we have the right people running, and if we're putting our support behind the right people, then we have a better chance of transforming systems. One of the things that I also want to say is that it's more than just voting. It's holding people accountable once they get into office. We have a habit of voting people in, and then we don't hold them accountable once they get into office. And we have to show up. We have to show up at the meetings. We have to show up at the hearings. And we have to show up before they already have the plan in place, so that we have input from the beginning, not after the train has already left the station and now we're trying to catch up. And so I think that you ask a good question. I think it's a question that we're going to have to really deeply think about. But I also think that we have to prepare people and groom people to run for office and put people in office who have our best interests at heart and who can transform systems.
And we have time.
Yep.
And we have time.
Yeah. And I want to add on to what Jelani was saying, because the thing is, like you're saying, that it does feel like the black community votes for the Democrats a lot because it's the lesser of two evils. But in reality, they're the same party. Systemic oppression that we see in America, that type of oppression can only be held over us if both parties was complicit in it. So that's what we need to understand. The Democrats and the Republicans, what we're talking about is the difference between someone going up there like Trump and saying, painting all Mexicans as rapists and murderers, and the difference between that and then someone like Biden, who is part of an administration that had the highest deportation rate of all time with Obama. Right. That's the difference. They're doing the same thing, but some people say it out loud and some people say kind words and say they care, when in reality, with their policies, they don't. That's why we need a new party. That's why we need a revolutionary party and a party for the people. Because right now, the Democrats and Republicans, the only thing that they're doing is they're trying to benefit themselves and their pockets and protect their property. And that's not what we need. We need what the people need.
I just want to give a quick fact check on black people vote for the Democrats, right? Black people this last election and elections previously have actually voted not to vote. Voted not to vote. More than they have voted for any person or party. There are a number of reasons for that. And then there are actually a lot of black people who their vote was suppressed. So let's think about this. This is the system of government we currently have. If we're gonna have a new party, we are allowed to. If we wanna stand up in a hearing, we are allowed to. If we wanna be in the streets protesting, we are allowed to. So when we are talking about what our rights are, these are rights that the Constitution validates, but these are rights that are inherent to us being on this land as people. So let's stand by that. You do not have to be 18 to reach out to your representative. You do not have to be documented to be in the streets and to be a person for change and to say what is right. You do not have to be registered to vote to see the change in our policies. And so that's what we're calling for. Even when we're talking about this mass incarceration system, they strip our rights to vote. And they're making decisions about prisoners, and prisoners are not at the table. And then we see prisoners dying, and we see prisoners being tortured. Even in COVID-19, we see prisoners being isolated and being silenced while they're getting COVID, and they're thinking, everybody got COVID in here, I'ma die. Right. And so where is their voice? Who are we to not listen to them? Because this country, the foundation of the values of this country is built upon freedom of speech, upon freedom. I mean, I'm gonna say it again. So what's free?
Is there any other questions? My name is Jonathan McClellan, and I was a national delegate for the DFL party. And I want Joe Biden and Kamala Harris to know that if you think that your lack of action is not affecting the delegates who helped get you into office. I was Bernie Sanders' national delegate, but after you took it, we helped you get into office. If you don't think that we're shook and we're asking where you are, wait till 2024.
I'll give one, and other people, please chime in. We need to end the war on drugs immediately.
Yes.
And we need to release those folks who are incarcerated solely on drug-related crimes from prison. Yep. Because we have demonized black and Latino men in this country for many years because of a connection to the war on drugs. And now that marijuana and other drugs are legal, in other parts of this country, white men are able to profit, become multimillionaires, and there is no demonization and no incarceration. That is not right for that to happen in that way. That is something that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris could work to do immediately, because they are also responsible for many of the drug war prisoners who are incarcerated. And we want to send a message to those who are incarcerated that we have not forgotten about you. We stand in solidarity with you, and we will continue fighting for you.
We put together, our collective of organizations put together some legislation here in the state of Minnesota that we're advancing right now that is sitting on empty desks. Number one was removing the statute of limitations on wrongful death, House File 717, prohibiting qualified immunity for law enforcement, House File 1104, releasing body camera footage within 48 hours, House File 1103, ending no-knock warrants, House File 1762, ending police-only responses to mental health calls, House File 1686, police professional liability insurance, House File 440, ending prosecution for reporting police misconduct, House File 2201, civilian oversight strengthened, House File 640. We also support the Hardale-Sherrill Act of 2021 and the Flandreau-Castile Omnibus Bill.
One more. So the third one is we need the federal government to reopen and open all of the investigations of officer-involved shootings that have been put on hold during the Trump administration immediately. We also want President Biden to immediately usher a task force using the Department of Justice and other departments to bring that law into every city when an officer-involved shooting happens, and we want to see that. And in the state of Minnesota, we know that there are three candidates right now to be the next U.S. attorney, and one of them has lost the faith in this community, Andrew Lugar. We don't want him back, and we need to make sure that if he brings someone like that back, there will be consequences for his party. So I think that's another pointer. And Amy Klobuchar, who supports him.
Mm-hmm.
So I was one of the 646 people arrested. The charges have still not been dismissed against us. We know that Governor Walz is using his leverage in supporting the city of Minneapolis and bringing in a militarized police force to keep those charges intact. It's a waste of time, energy, and resources to keep those charges hanging over our heads. We're encouraging all 646 people, if they are able to do so, it's not legal advice, but if they're able to do so, to fight their charges. And as far as people being arrested, as far as we understand, we have jail support that has been happening through the National Lawyers Guild and the Legal Rights Center, and people are typically being released within 36 hours of being detained.
All right, thank you.
Any other questions? All right, well, we want to thank you all for taking the time to be here with us. You see that we have some very serious concerns about what's happening in the state of Minnesota. The Black community is not safe. We have been neglected, and we are using our voices to demand that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris take action. Thank you.